worship here at St. John's Anglican Church in Bowmanville. We are delighted that you are here with us. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without whom nothing is strong, nothing is holy, increase and multiply upon us your mercy, that with you as our ruler and God, we may so pass through things temporal that we lose not the things eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Such a thing. And David said to Uriah, remain here today also, and tomorrow I will send you back. So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day. On the next day, David invited him to eat and drink in his presence and made him drunk. And in the evening, he went out to lie on his couch with his servants of his Lord. But he did not go down to his house. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. In the letter he wrote, "Set Uriah in the forefront of the harvest fighting, and then draw back from him, so that he may be struck down and die." Hear what the Spirit is saying to us now.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter to the Ephesians. I bow my knees down before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth take its name. I pray that, according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Hear what the Spirit is saying to us now.
Thanks be to God.
They were about to come and try to take him by force to make him king. He withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I, do not be afraid." Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land toward which they were going. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Holy Spirit, speak in each of our hearts. Amen. The kids were preschoolers who had been clamoring for me to play a game of Candyland. So we eagerly got out the board and started setting up. As I got out the cards, I heard the first squeal. "Hey, I get the purple piece. That's mine." "No, it's mine. I got it first." "I called it first. You can't grab it. You always get it. You're mean." "I'm not mean. You're mean. Give it to me." "No, it's mine. Ow, you hurt me. David hears the story, he is furious at the rich man. Nathan zeroes in on the real problem, which is David's mistaken belief that he does not have enough. David's mistaken belief that he has to take more, and that if he can just get more, then this time it will finally make him happy. So David takes Bathsheba and just ends up making himself and everyone else more miserable than ever. This story stands in sharp contrast to the account of the feeding of the multitude in today's gospel. There are 5,000 men, plus women and children, all of them hungry. 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little, and the disciples have nowhere near that kind of money lying around. There is one boy who has his lunch, 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. It would be very understandable if a boy who had brought his lunch and found himself in the middle of a hungry crowd decided that the best thing to do would be to eat his lunch fast before somebody swiped it. In the middle of scarcity, it is the most natural thing in the world to guard what you have. But this boy does not do that. Instead, he gives his lunch to Jesus. And from the boy's giving away what he has, even though it seems inadequate, Jesus is able to provide food not only for the boy, but for everyone. They all have enough. They are full. They are satisfied. David, who has plenty of riches, plenty of power, plenty of wives, mistakenly believes that he doesn't have enough. So he focuses on what he doesn't have, takes, and it leads to misery. The boy, who has a simple lunch, believes he has enough, focuses on what he does have, gives, and it leads to miracles. It is the people who mistakenly believe they do not get enough love, who are manipulative or clingy, jealous or accusing, distant or judgmental. And of course, they end up driving away the very thing they crave. It is the people who feel that the love in their lives is enough, who can extend themselves in kindness and compassion and generosity toward others. And when they give their love, they end up with even more. And this difference exists within each one of us. We can choose to focus on what we don't have, mistakenly believing there is not enough for us. Or we can choose to focus on what we do have and open our eyes to the enormous possibilities God has given us in our lives. The two preschoolers who are capable of bitter fights over who gets the purple piece in Candyland are also capable of enjoying playing with their toys together to the point where they are overcome with giggles and squeals of glee. When they shift their focus away superhero, or can be cut into tiny bits and used as a shower of snow. The kids see the enormous potential in the cardboard roll that paper towels come in, or an acorn, or a scrap of string. And they bring these treasures to each other, exclaiming, "Look, look what I found. This will be great for our dolls." And they build on each other's ideas with the wonder of shared creativity. And there is so much potential in their play that when they have to go to bed, they can hardly bear to leave all of the magnificent abundance that surrounds them, which seems to be almost sparkling with possibilities for their fun. It is not just the objects in the room that have been transformed. The children themselves have been transformed. The boy in our gospel passage takes some things God has created, fish and barley, and gives them to Jesus. Jesus takes these things, gives thanks for them, and distributes them to others. And there is an abundant plenty. Jesus does not explain exactly how this miracle operates, how 5 loaves and 2 fish become more than enough for thousands of people. He simply doesn't. I do not understand miracles, but I believe in them. And so it seems like a logical thing to shift my own focus away from focusing on what I do not have, on my own mistaken beliefs that there is not enough, and to focus instead on the amazing amount that God has given me, the splendor of creation, the warmth of loving relationships, the ability to learn and to do, and most important of all, the capacity to give. This congregation is a loaves and fishes congregation. The people of St. John's are giving with generous hearts to their church and to its ministries. You meet challenges with resourcefulness rather than self-pity. You give welcome and hospitality to strangers, food and clothing to the migrant workers and the hamper recipients, labor to church activities, prayer and compassion to those who are hurting. This congregation can adapt to changing circumstances with flexibility and creativity. And that adaptability comes from an attention to seeing the blessings we do have and focusing on the potential for good that is in them. God's gifts to us are abundant and generous, and we can give to others and to God from that generous abundance and watch as God performs miracles. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Inspire us to hunger and thirst for what is right.
prayer.
Teach us to use your creation for your greater praise, that all may share the good things you provide.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Strengthen all who give their energy or skill for the healing of those who are sick in body or in mind.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Set free all those who are bound by fear and despair.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Grant a peaceful end and eternal rest to all who are dying, and your comfort to those who mourn.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bless those we name in our hearts, and all who need the grace of your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for who are celebrating their birthdays this week: Eric Andrus, Linda Dempsey, and Barbara McPherson. Watch over your children, Erica, Linda, and Barbara. O Lord, as their days increase, bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall, and in their hearts may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us give thanks to God our Father, always and for everything, saying, we thank you, Lord, for the beauty and wonders of creation.
We thank you, Lord,
for all that is gracious in the lives of men and women, revealing the image of Christ.
We thank you, Lord,
for our daily food, for our homes and families and friends.
We thank you, Lord,
for minds to think and hearts to love.
We thank you, Lord,
for health and strength and skill to work and for leisure to rest and play.
We thank you, Lord,
for those who are brave and courageous, patient in suffering and faithful in adversity.
We thank you, Lord,
for all who pursue peace, justice, and truth.
We thank you, Lord,
for our church community of St. John's and for its ministries.
We thank you, Lord,
for all those whose gifts to our church make these ministries possible.
We thank you, Lord,
for the blessing in our lives.
We thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning. My name is David Crowe, and I've been asked to share with you my life at St. John's and why I love this church family and the house of worship. Also, I've been asked to share how and why I contribute financially, as well as my time and talents, to the ongoing growth of St. John's. I'm a lifelong Anglican, born and raised, and in my early years, because my dad had been killed overseas, I was very much influenced by my grandfather, who was an Anglican minister, who represented everything I thought a Christian represented. Over the years, I learned to enjoy the content, the dogma, the scriptures and traditions of the Anglican service, and most importantly, it provided me with the foundation for my faith journey. In 2008, my wife Susan and I moved from Port Perry to Bowmanville. After a summer search, we chose St. John's as our place of worship. The following strongly influenced our ongoing commitment to St. John's. Within a month of arriving in Bowmanville, Reverend Kip Reeves visited us at our home, and not only did he share his warm and welcoming personality, but he shared his spiritual perspective of St. John's and what he hoped to achieve. The very first time we walked through those doors at the front and the back of the church, we were warmly welcomed by many of the parishioners. There was no judgment. They were genuinely sincere, but most importantly, most welcoming. Over the years, St. John became the hub of our community and spiritual life. Focus on helping others and making Jesus known were very important to me personally. Examples with migrant workers, I remember vividly the dinners we had for them and how much they enjoyed their time with us. Teaching Sunday school and the enthusiasm of the young children as they learned about scriptures. And participation in the multiple festivals that occurred in the community. I became enamored by the history and beauty of this church. Most important, with our respective hectic lives, I thrived on the peace and tranquility of my 1 hour attending the church services, always refreshing my love and commitment to God. How and why I chose to contribute my financial resources, my talents, and my time to St. John's. When I was a warden both up in Port Perry and here at St. John's, I quickly learned that the church is a seven-day responsibility, not just here on Sunday. Heat, lights, maintenance, administration are ongoing responsibilities, especially in an older church. I was profoundly influenced by the need to support my valued church, both as a parish and its community outreach. With that in mind, I prioritized my personal budget to ensure the maintenance of the growth of St. John's, not only financially, but through of time and talents. As a parishioner of this church family, I am sincerely motivated to water the St. John's seed, to participate in the growth of everything that St. John's means to me.
serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.